morning. Good morning, guys. Welcome to the Council of Regional Remarks. Somebody will complain about the video painting that is available only as a file. So he told me that he emailed me that if he had only to watch 5 minutes, he had to download 100 megabytes or so. I checked with the data service they put online, and they told me they had changes on the platform, the e-learning platform, and by tomorrow or so it should be okay. So you will have these videotaped lectures in the same format as the other lectures, so you can watch online in different formats, whatever it is. Then, what else? What kind of circuit simulator, electrical simulator do you use?
Anti-spice,
do you know it? Yes? Okay. I put online a few examples of a buffer worker in anti-spice. You will put the source file, ASC file, S file, and with some commentary with them. Basically, I prepared a buffer worker, very high current, current and low voltage. I think it's something like 0.9 volts, the output voltage and 90 amps. That is something really weird, really extreme. And I put an example of a standard buck converter with very bad performances. I put an example of a synchronous converter. What's the difference between a standard buck converter and a synchronous converter?
Synchronous is a MOSFET.
Instead of a diode, in a synchronous converter you have an MOS. This is very important for low voltage output circuit, because a diode has a voltage drop that is at least half a volt. If you put instead of a volt diode MOS transistor, you have a voltage drop that is far lower, so that your efficiency goes up, as you will see. Then I put a multi-phase converter with the three phases together, so you can check what are the stresses on different components. And that should be all. Oh, one thing that I forgot to mention about the synchronous converter is that if you have a synchronous converter with two switches, two MOS transistors, whatever they are, and remember, in parallel to an MOS transistor, there is always a diode, a body diode, and if instead of an MOS transistor you use an IGBT, the GBT has not this body diode inside, but the manufacturer, the IGBT manufacturer, put a diode in the same case in parallel to the IGBT in order to have this kind of behavior. So, if you use an MOS, two MOS transistors, that's something like this. Well, in CCM, your current will be something like that, your inductor current will be something like that, and in average, the inductor current is, you should know by now, the average of the inductor current is Did you say not? What happens if the output current decreases? Because, for example, the load increases its value, it sinks less current. Well, this average comes down, and the ripple stays the same if the voltages stay the same. So your ripple will be something like this. It's still CCM? Yes. Why? Because the minimum current does not reach. If you go even further, decreasing the output current, what happens is that, for example, if your output current is doing this, ripple will go up and down around the average voltage, and current of the inductor will be negative. It will flow backward. Why? Because during T off, this is T off. During T off, this switch is closed. On this side of the inductor you have V naught, on this side of the inductor you have zero volt. So, when current goes to zero, you don't have current that opens. When the current goes to zero, it grabs. Here you have a positive voltage, here you have a zero voltage, current will start to flow backwards, coming down to the, through this closed switch. When you open the switch, because the next cycle is going to start over here, you will close this switch, and even if you don't close it immediately, current will flow back through this diode, going back to the source, but the voltage over here at that time will be waiting, and current will start to rise again. So, is this the right the waveform of CCS or CCM? CCM, because there is no period of time where this current stays constant. It goes to zero, but it only passes to zero. It does not stay at zero. So it does not stay constant. Is this behavior good or not good? Well, you can say both. It's good because you can change mode. Your converter, even with very low output current, has still the good properties of a CCM buck converter. It makes most important the output voltage is constant, the gain is just Vin, and so the output voltage, the output voltage depends only on the duty cycle, does not depend on the load current. Output voltage has a very low differential resistance, and so on the other hand, let's suppose to have a very small output current. You have energy that goes from the source to the LC system, basically L, and then comes back. Goes forward, comes back, and bouncing energy forth and back decreases your efficiency. So in some cases, even if you are in a synchronous rectification, synchronous buck converter, that means you can stay CCM all the time, if the output current is very low, in order to improve efficiency, or in order not to waste too much power, when you go at very low current, you don't use this S2 anymore, you use a standard converter, so it goes DCM, and you don't have this function forward and back of energy between input and inductor. In some cases, when the output load is very low, for many converters, not only for a buck converter, what they do is they switch off everything. They work for a while, let's say 200 cycles, and then they switch off for a while until the output voltage decreases. Then they pump the output voltage up again, and this is called the burst mode. There's a burst of activity, and then nothing for a while. Burst of activity, and then nothing for a while. Those are just tricks to avoid wasting too much power. And it happens when you have a very high flow. Okay, that is something that they forgot to tell you about the synchronous rectification. Etispice, you know Etispice? Yes, say yes, everybody knows it. I will put online some links to the download website that is Linear Technology and to the instructions, but you should know by now. And I will give you examples of circuits that we analyze in Etispice. Then, what else? Oh, is there anybody interested to work on the LaTeX note for this class? No, you have a PDF power file website. It was prepared by a former student of this class many years ago. They were basically real-time notes. It was taking notes in LaTeX, basically, almost so. If somebody wants to work on it, improving, changing, etc., let me know. And last point, you see why I might not work here. Last point is, today there is lag. At 4 o'clock, ouch, because 4 o'clock means that we would end around 7 o'clock. We started, you started, we started, I started. This morning at 8:30, we will end tonight at the 7. That's a long day. A long power day. There will be lab. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. About 35 or so. If you are 30 or so, we can stay in lab 8. Otherwise, I also reserved room number 7, then 7 and then 8, but if we can stay in one room only, I do prefer. Today is an official lab. If you want to come, you are welcome. If you don't want to come, you are welcome as well. It's not a big deal. Today we will see something new, that it was not on the blackboard, and I will show you that I was telling you something wrong, and you will discover that it was wrong in my during the experiment, during the measurement, but I will repeat the same stuff next Friday for everybody else. So if you want to come to the lab today, please enroll in the lab reservation page that is on the website, on the lab website, under Power Electronics class. Each table can host about 4 people, so if you are groups of 3 or 4 people, just enroll in the reservation page in the lab web page. For next weeks, we will return to the lab, but it won't be an official lab, it will be just on a voluntary basis. I will happen to be in the lab at Tuesday evening at 4 p.m. If you pass by and you want to make some experiment, this is just for some kind of bureaucratic reason. There's nothing different between today and next weeks. I do repeat, it's not required, it's not mandatory, it does not help you for the exam grade coming to the lab. If you are interested in the electronics or power electronics, you want to put your hands on power electronics, please come, otherwise you can survive without my lab. Okay? That's good. Especially if you were a microwave guy that was forced to come to take this class, are you? Yeah? And you, I can say it because it's really too bad as an expression. If you don't care about this class, it's okay. You just try to survive. Do you have classes at 2:30 this afternoon? Because the lab is free, so I was wondering if it was possible to anticipate the lab. Now, who will meet that? So far, so good? So, what about the homework I put online? Did you read it at least? Yes? No? No? That was the design of a buck converter with some specifications. I gave you a trace how to solve it for a few points, and for some other points that I wrote in the like, we will see it in class. Anyway, we have aspects to this activity. Input voltage goes from 20 to 28. Output voltage 12 volts. Output current goes from
0.5
amps up to 5 amps. That is a range. Those are ranges. And I put a note something like here, 12 volts in real life. You don't have only this nominal value, you also have indications about stability, about precision. How precise must be this 12 volt? 5%, 1%? How stable must be this 12 volt? Stable with respect to the temperature changes, stable with respect to the aging of components, stable with respect to the change in the load, stable with respect to the change in the input voltage. And then I put here a ripple voltage, output ripple voltage, peak to peak. 100 milliwatts, 50 milliwatts, 100 milliwatts, and you will have something similar to this for your final exam with one extra step, and the extra requirement I put in the final exam is isolate. We cannot design an isolated converter right now because we don't know it yet, but we can design this stuff. The only converter is a converter, so let's try to design a buck converter having these specs. Basic schematic is 1, not add the SCA. Break A, positive negative, A not positive negative. Oh, by the way, the range of 20 volts to 28 volts is more or less the voltage range you can find in a clock or in an airplane, something that has a nominal voltage of 24 volts. This is not the extreme voltages you can find in a car or in a truck or something like this. This is just a normal interval, the normal range, voltage range of your electric system. When you crank your truck, when you crank your airplane, the battery voltage can go down below 10 volts, especially 49, etc. In some cases, your voltage can go above 28 volts, up to 32 or so. This is just a normal state. When you flash your lights, or you change it off, or you have a relay switching in your truck, the instantaneous voltage jumps up to 100 volts or down to negative 50 volts for a very short time. So this is just a DC component. Then you can have a very short disturbances that are 50 volts or quite common. And so it means that in a real design, you have to provide those specs and, in many cases, to provide the protection for other voltages. That is a different story, unfortunately, not in this place. Okay, this is our schematic. I put here the symbol of an MOS transistor because having low voltages, probably the MOS transistor is the best switch you can choose. You could choose a bipolar transistor, but bipolar transistors have the only advantage, I do repeat, only advantage of cost. A bipolar transistor usually costs a little bit less than an MOS transistor with equivalent characteristics. But an MOS transistor can switch quite faster, and having a fast switch over here means you can go up in frequency, you can have a small inductor. Smaller inductor means less cost, less volume, less weight. So MOS is the standard choice for low voltages. Here, for the freewheeling part, I could choose between a synchronous rectifier, synchronous buck, or standard one. Output voltage is, it's not too low. Input voltage maximum is 28 volts. So this diode can easily be a Schottky diode. Schottky diode has a voltage drop that is direct forward voltage drop for the diode. Schottky diode is 0.5 volts. So 0.5 volts out of 12 is not enough. If the output voltage is 5 volts, I start to consider to put here a switch, an MOS transistor. If the output voltage is 2.5 volts, I will definitely consider to have here a switch. If the output voltage is 1 volt, no way to do something different than placing here a switch, not a diode. Okay? So far so good. So, output power is 12 volts times 5 amps, it's 60 watts. Voltages are low voltages, so we can have, we have to choose basically a frequency. What frequency did you choose in your design?
You guys? 200
kHz.
200?
200? 200. What kind of a circuit are you using? If everything is integrated into one IC, you can go up easily to 500 kHz or more. If you have external MOS transistor with possibly an MOS driver, so your frequency has to come down. It's a reasonable switching frequency, 200 kHz. It's this one. If something goes wrong, you can blame the cable. Say thank you. Because everybody will blame. Just kidding, obviously. 200 kHz. This is the output, the maximum output power. I put a spec on the minimum output current, 0.5 amps. Sometimes it's there, sometimes it's not. In some cases, the minimum output current could be zero. And The minimum output current could be helpful, and if it's not, you can choose a different value. It could be helpful to decide for what range of output load your system stays in CCM or loads in DCM. This is a buckle. Do we design it for CCM or DCM? CCM, because CCM has less, smaller stresses, current stresses. And in order to have a CCM, not converted in CCM, we need to use an inductor that is larger than. What was the equation, the formula for the function?
1 minus D.
1 minus D times
R
divided by twice the switching frequency. Well, we know this. How much is it?
200 kilo.
What resistance do we need? Maximum, minimum, so on and so on.
Maximum
resistance and minimum. To decycle, how much is it to decycle? D, more or less, is equal to. We are in CCM. We design for CCM, so D is equal to
the
output voltage divided by the input voltage. Why? It's just an approximation, this expression.
We are considering the resistance of component, ideal.
We neglected losses, and no idea components, resistances, parasitic resistance. So, but this is okay to use this equation for initial design. Oh, by the way, if you get crazy and you want to design this converter for DCM, nobody wants to do it. But if you need, you will have to reverse this inequality, so it will be L less than. You have to take here the minimum resistance, here the maximum design. How do you determine this with design? You will determine this with the cycle with the same equation, even if this is an equation that we derived for CCM and we derived for DCM. This equation was derived for the boundary condition between CCM and DCM. So on the boundary, you can pick whichever you want. You can stay on the CCM side or the DCM side. CCM side is easier, has this equation that is an easy equation. So we can use this equation, find out the D, CCM, that will be the D for boundary, and go even for the, to that equation, even if we decide for DCM, but we won't. How much is D? Well, D, we need the minimum. And minimum D occurs when?
Minimum.
D is mass. So it will be something like 12 volts divided by 28 volts. How much is 12 divided by
28?
0.23. 43? 43. The actual to decycle, that is minimum. The actual to decycle will be slightly longer than this. Because this has no losses included. When you put losses, the to decycle goes up. But it's okay, because here we need the minimum, and we stay below the minimum, we are fine. Oh, by the way, don't choose minimum duty cycle 0, so I am sure that I am at the absolute minimum. Don't overkill your problem, because if you overkill your problem, your cost goes up. And a good engineering design has its cost effective. So, what about Rmax? Okay, Rmax should be equal to, Rmax is just a model of our output load. V naught over I naught min, minimum, that is 12 volts divided by 0.5 amps, that is 24 ohms. Not guaranteed, your load is not guaranteed to be a resistance. We will see what happens if we change this specification in about 1 month. But this could be our maximum load. Be careful. Because, what if I give you a minimum output current, in the specs instead of being 500 milliamps, the minimum output current would be 50 milliamps. That is a spec. Spec is not under your control. You are the designer for the control for the converter. A customer is asking you for his or her application to design this converter. So if the minimum current was 50 milliamps, one could say, okay, put over here 50 milliamps, and 12 volts divided by 50 milliamps gives me a maximum load resistance of
240
ohms. If I put here 240 ohms instead of 24 ohms, what happens? It happens that my inductor value, goes up by a factor of 10. Instead of this inductance, I need to use that inductance. And what if the minimum load is zero? Because my customer tells me, I can disconnect it. Well, if I put here zero, 12 divided by zero is. Don't say infinity. 12 divided by zero is.
Very bad now.
Impossible. But if the load goes to zero, the load resistance goes to infinity, this goes to infinity, and L goes to infinity. No way! When your load becomes light, your converter will eventually jump into DCL. No other ways to do it. You have to do it. What is a reasonable point, a reasonable interval, current interval, where you can have the boundary from CCM and DCM? Well, let's see what happens. I have T, this is my output current. For example, to be 5 amps. If I put here a very small, tiny little ripple in it, it means that this current can come down a lot, and my system stays in CCM. But in order to get this small ripple, I need an expensive, large inductor. Is it a good choice?
No.
On the other hand, I could say, let's suppose that my max current is 5 amps, my minimum current is 4 amps. So I mean my load goes from 2.4 ohms to 3 ohms. What happens? If I design for this minimum current, my ripple current will be... I have to go up a bit, comes down there. When the output current from 5 amps comes down by 1 amp, it comes down to 4 amps over here, this red waveform will move down, keeping the same shape, the same amplitude, but they will move down, and they will stay here still in CCM. I am still in CCM, my converter was 12, but you see, you have a very large ripple. Very large ripple means high stress in capacitors, in inductor. Very large ripple means that the peak is almost twice as much the average of the current. So it's not a good choice. A good choice for the current ripple is something like 10-15% at minimum of the output current, or 20%, 25%, something like this. Don't make it too small. It's useless. You need a large inductor to get it. Don't make it too large, because if you make it too large, it's you have a very high peak current, so current stresses on your components increase. A reasonable amount of this ripple is, let's say, 10%, 20%. 20% is what I think, usually, of the output current. Or, if I translate this ripple requirement to the Rmax, I can choose an IO min if it is not given. And if it is given, it's not reasonable. IO min could be in the order of IO max divided by any number, any reasonable number would be 10. But you can go from 5, probably 5, 6, something like this, to 20. Usually I stay here in the middle. So So, if I give you for your final exam or for your real life, professional life, an IOM, that is in this range of the IOMAX, you can design your converter to take CCM from IOMAX down to IOM. If your IOM is not given, or if your IOM is very close to IOMAX, constant low, or your IOM is incredibly low, well, you can say, if your IOM is 50 milliamps, 5 milliamps, 1 milliamp, and the maximum is 5 amps, you can say, okay, down to 500 milliamps, down to half an amp, 0.3 amps or so, I stay in CCM, and then I accept to go in DCM. I lose some performances, but I will save on the cost, on the weight, on the size for the output. So, don't go too much high on this side. If you go too much down on the other side, you can say, okay, my inductor is smaller, but my current stress is increased. To all the components, my current stress is increased. This is a matter of personal sensitivity. You have to feel it after a while. But if you stay in this range, usually it's okay. So far, so good. Here, I gave you a good hint. An output current, the minimum output current at this one time on the mass, the maximum output current, that's what I mean. This is the range where I want your system to stay in CCM. If I don't give you this, or I give you an unreasonable value for that, you have to say, okay, I will design it like this and warn my customer that something wrong could happen. He can lose, he or she can lose some performances at very long time. You will see next time we'll be seeing four or five sessions, four or five labs, we'll be seeing. Okay, so minimum duty cycle is 0.43. Rmax, that is what I need here, is 24 ohms. L is then larger than 1 minus. Times 24 ohms divided by 2 times 200 kilohertz equals 1 minus 0.43 is 0.57. 0.57 times 24, that's it. It's like 6 times 24. 6 times 24 is like 12 times 12. 12 times 12 is 124. Okay, so, oh wait, this is not 0.6, this is 0.57. 0.57 is 6% less, 5% less than 0.60. So the result will be 5% less of 144. How much is 5% of 144? How much?
7.
144 minus 7 is?
137
or so. So let's put it here. So 13.7, because this is 20, this is 1, so the result must be in the order of 20, divided by 2 times 200.
400.
Really? 400 kilohertz. That means 0.4 megahertz, and this is ohms, equals 13.7 divided by 4. 3? Okay, something better. 3.5. 3.5. 3.5. Little bit less than 3.5. Oh, wait. Let's do the calculation, and please, for people who already attended my class on Circuit Electronics, they already know this, and for the other guys, this is the way that I suggest you to make calculations. Is first, your calculation have to include three steps. First step, numbers. 13.7 divided by 0.4 is something 3.535. First pass numbers, second pass prefixes. However, what is the prefix of ohms here in front? There is a kilo, milli, mega, nothing. One. Here there's a mega downstairs, and if you move this mega up, the reciprocal of mega is micro. Don't go to 10 to the 6, 10 to the minus 6, because it's just a waste of time. Use the prefixes. They are easy. The reciprocal of mega is micro. Yes, in the beginning you can start to think, oh, mega is 10 to the 6th, but 10 to the minus 6 is micro. But after a while, it becomes automatic. So, you get micro. And then, ohms divided by hertz is angle. Three passes, numbers, prefixes, and units. And if you notice, I put units in all my equations. Always. Because it's a good way to know what you are doing, the good way to check errors, dimensional errors, and so on. So, your inductors have to be larger than 35 microhenries if you want to bring the CCM down to 0.5 amps. Then, you have to consider that the inductors have tolerances. Switching frequency has tolerances because the switching frequency is determined by an R and C and some electronics. So R and C have tolerances and electronics have manufacturing tolerances. So don't stay exactly at this number. You have to increase it. How much?
From
10 to 20%, something like this. Okay, if we increase this to by 20%, what do we get?
42
microhenries. Do we have to normalize this value? Yeah. Better to normalize it, because in many cases the inductor is already available in the market. You can get an inductor that has inductance, a normalized inductance, and it's able to carry 5 amps or whatever it is. So we increase this by 10%, 20% or so. If we increase it by 10%, we get 38.5. If we increase by 20%, we get 42. What are the normalized values that are around?
39.
There is 39 microhenries or 47. Which one do you want?
39.
It's not very important. You can take 37 would be okay. 39 could be okay. You can go to 47 could be okay. Obviously 47 quite likely is more expensive than a 39 microhenries inductor. You could say yes, but the 39 microhenries is just 10% more than this. If the switching frequency moves away and the approximation I put into this equation, it could happen that at 0.5 amps, I go just a little bit into DCM. Is it important? No. Because the choice, let's stay in CCM from 0.5 to 5 amps, is my choice. If I had chosen 0.6 amps, it was okay. It was 0.4 amps, it was okay. So don't worry too much about this. 10%, 20%. You like 39 microhenries? Let's go for 39. You are very conservative and pessimistic and want to stay up to 47, that's okay. I don't care too much about that. 13L is 39 microhenries, and from this point on, this is the value we have to use for further calculations. Just forget the 35. Now our reference value is this 39 microhenries or 47 if you want to use a 47. Then what else do we have to evaluate? We have to find out the delta IL variation, peak to peak. There is delta IL.
What was that?
current in a dial bar.
Current in a dial?
Yeah, it's a specific period.
Are you talking about dial current?
Yeah.
Okay, we will see that in a moment. Because we have to go through all the components. Delta S, how much is this delta IS? This is the ripple. It does not depend on the ripple. It is the ripple. How much is it? We can find it using this going up slope or this coming down slope. Coming down slope is easier because here you have in and been up. Here you have only the up slope. So easier calculation. And it is something like V naught or S times 1 minus V over switching frequency. 1 minus V over switching frequency is this time. In microseconds, in whatever in seconds. 1 minus V, if I want the maximum delta L, do I have to take here the minimum or the maximum of V?
Minimum.
Ah, you already know it. Minimum V is 0.43. So, delta IL equals output voltage. 12 volts. You want to be really picky and precise and, I won't say cool in this case. You want to be really precise, you can say, oh, look, in a buck converter, during the downcoming phase, interval, the voltage across inductor is 12 volts on one side, the output voltage on one side, and the other side is not zero, it is negative 0.5. So, during E off, here on the right hand side, we have V naught, 12 volts in our case. Here we don't have 0 volts. Here we have negative VD, the voltage drop. So, if you want to be very, very precise, it's not worthwhile at this point. Could be a little bit later around the end of this class, of this course, but you can put here plus VD. But it's not worthwhile. Divided by L, L was. L was
39
microamps, not this one. This just forget, never existed. Times 1 minus V, that is 0.43. Times 12. A good reason to put units is that if I forget the switching frequency, well, voltage divided by inductance is not giving me amps. It's giving me amps per second. It's giving me a current rate, not a current. So I say, oh, there is something missing. But if I only write down 12 times a number divided by 39, it can be anything. Put your unit every time you write down even numbers. How much is it?
0.88.
This is 0.88. This means that your current, your inductor current, will ride around the output current or here, and the maximum ripple that it can have is 0.88 amps. This is the maximum ripple you can have. It's not always 0.88 amps. If your input voltage goes down, your disciple decreases, 1 minus D decreases, and your ripple decreases. That's okay. So this ripple is 0.88 amps across, around the outer cover, and it means that the negative part comes down, decreases from the outer current by, how much is this?
1/2,
because this is a triangle. Triangle has a straight edges, a straight line. So this is 0.44 amps. Double check if our inductance calculation is right. Let's assume, let's consider what happens when the outer current goes down to the minimum current. The minimum current is 0.5 amps. Ripple amplitude stays the same. The ripple amplitude is only given by the input voltage and the output voltage, because it's a duty cycle, a related duty cycle switching frequency and input and output voltage and output voltage. So I will have 0.5 amps average. And on top of it, there is a ripple rising, and this ripple is 0.44 amps below the average. 0.5 minus 0.44, how much is it? 60 milliamps. It's still a positive number, so I am still in CCM. And I am not far away from the DCM. I'm just close to the DCM region. That's okay. My inductance value is right, or is what I expect. On the other hand, if instead of considering this is just a check, it's not important for the design, it's just to check that your calculations were right. What I can do with this delta L is something like finding what is the maximum, the peak values for my curves. IL will be something like this. The maximum, absolute maximum, the top I can reach will be, it will occur when the output current is 5 amps and the ripple is maximum, and so this value will be something like
5.44
amps. And the minimum, just to show me that you can make also subtractions, not only additions.
5.56.
4.56. I heard a 5. Okay, so you prove that you can subtract. So, we have numbers for this way. We can choose the components, we can evaluate the stresses. Please observe that the only value, only component value that you get from this design is the inductor. 39 microhenries. From that point on, it's just based on the choice of components, just based on the stresses. So, L, what number do we need for L to determine L to be able to look for an inductance of our data sheet and our manufactured cable? L must be nominal 39 microhenries. I peak to the inductance. This is used for saturation. You don't want your inductor to saturate. Hey, how much is the maximum current that can flow to the inductance? That's it. This is the maximum, because it was evaluated using the maximum output current or the maximum ripple that we can have on top of it. So, that would be 5.42 amps or so. This is magnetic required. If your current goes above this, your inductance should not suffer. Actually, inductors to find the alternative have an inductance value that goes down as the current goes up. It's not too bad. Then we need IL RMS, because the RMS current is important for the resisting losses. How much power does it dissipate in wine? How much is the Aramesh carbon for this example?
Five hours.
Really 5 hours? Really 5 hours. Absolutely precisely 5 amps? No, because the RMS current, you have DC component and IC component, so you can add them quadratically. But if you add them quadratically, you just